his question, a brother had asked me a question pertaining to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's marriage to his adopted son's wife. Then he's talking about Zayd ibn Harithah, may Allah be pleased with him, and his wife Zaynab bint Jahsh, who was the Prophet's cousin. Could you please shed some more light on the circumstances surrounding this particular event and the fact that it was only an exemption for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not for anyone else? It seems that brother Tariq is dictating to me the answer by saying that the fact that it was only an exemption for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, it would be better to ask, what is the explanation of that? Why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do so? First of all, the incident is recorded in Surah Al-Ahzab, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began in the surah in verse number 4 by saying, وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ قَوْلُكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَقُولُ الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ يَهْدِ السَّبِيلِ. In verse number 4 of Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, amongst what he said in that verse, وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. أدعياءكم, similar to adoption, because adoption was known even before Islam. A person would just pick up any person and would claim him to himself, would give him his last name, him or her. Mainly they would do that with the boys, of course. They used to get rid of the girls. So an incident happened when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given Zayd ibn Haritha as a gift. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his parents came to him and asked him if he can send him free, and they would be willing to pay whatever amount of money he would ask for. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, or I will give you a better offer. And the better offer was that ask him if he would like to go with you, then he's free. And if he likes to stay with me, then this is his call. So Zayd chose to live with the Prophet ﷺ and preferred that over going with his uncle and his father as a free person. So when this happened, the Prophet ﷺ declared to the Meccan that Zayd isn't a slave anymore. Zayd is my son, and he gave him his last name, and he was known afterward as Zayd ibn Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam honored Zayd for choosing him to stay with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a servant over going with his parents. The Prophet honored him by declaring that Zayd has become his son, and he gave him his last name, so he became Zayd ibn Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abrogated that concept of adoption in that format where a person would adopt a child and would give him his last name. He said no. وَمَا جَعَلَ أَدْعِيَاءَكُمْ أَبْنَاءَكُمْ. Your adopted sons or daughters are not your actual sons. You take care of them, fine. You sponsor them, great. You raise them, wonderful. You look after orphans, you have a great status in heaven with the Prophet ﷺ, as he said that أَنَا وَكَافِرُ الْيَتِيمِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَهَاتَيْنِ. Me and the person who sponsors an orphan will be in heaven like these two, with me in heaven like these two fingers, close to me like these two fingers. But to give him your last name, and that also means that he's become like your own line, become a mahram to your wife and to your daughters? No, that is not true. That's invalid. So you're adopted. Children are not your actual children. ذَلِكُمْ قَوْلُكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَقُولُ الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ يَهْدِ السَّبِيلِ. This is just a statement by your mouth, and Allah says the truth, and He guides to the straight path. Then in verse number 37, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, in the same chapter, gives us a glimpse over the story which the brother is asking about, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam honored Zayd, who's now known as Zayd ibn Muhammad, by giving him Zaynab, the Prophet's cousin, by giving Zaynab to Zayd as a wife. which was a great honor for Zayd because she was Qurashiya, an honorable family. Then it didn't work out. Every once in a while, Zaynab would come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and ask for a divorce, and she doesn't want to live with him. And Zayd would do the same thing. He felt that there is no chemistry, there is no match. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as if he predicted what was going on, so he would ask Zayd to be patient and to try to tolerate that, and it will work out after a while, and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in verse number 37, وَإِذْ تَقُولُ excuse me, وَإِذْ تَقُولُ لِلَّذِي أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَأَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْسِكْ عَلَيْكَ زَوْجَكَ وَتُخْفِي وَاتَّقِ اللَّهِ وَتُخْفِي فِي نَفْسِكَ مَا اللَّهُ مُبِدِيهِ وَتَخْشَى النَّاسَ وَاللَّهُ أَحَقُّ أَنْ تَخْشَى. The verse is talking about the fact that the feeling of the Prophet ﷺ when he was asking Zayd to keep Zaynab in his marriage. And Zaynab wanted divorce, and Zayd too. And the Prophet ﷺ knew what was going on. He expected that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Zayd would divorce Zaynab, the Prophet ﷺ would be commanded to marry Zaynab. Zaynab was the Prophet's cousin, and she was free before marrying Zayd. And it was the Prophet ﷺ who proposed Zaynab to Zayd. So if he was interested in marrying her from the beginning, it would be a great honor for her. She would have loved it. But he ordered her to marry Zayd. So why would he have an interest in a woman who's married to his now and until then adopted son? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala canceled and abrogated the idea of adoption in that sense, as I said in the beginning. And in order to confirm that practically, this whole thing was prearranged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now Zayd divorces Zaynab. And now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to marry Zaynab after the iddah was over. فَلَمَّا قَضَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا وَطَرًا زَوَجْنَكَهَا لِكَيْ لَا يَكُونَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ حَرَجٌ فِي أَزْوَاجِ أَدْعِيَائِهِمْ إِذَا قَضَوْا مِنْهُنَّ وَطَرًا وَكَانَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ مَفْعُولًا. What does it mean? When Zayd divorces Zaynab and the iddah was over, قَضَى مِنْهَا وَطَرًا. فَلَمَّا قَضَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا وَطَرًا, and it was over, زَوَجْنَكَهَا, and we need to put many lines after under that word زَوَّجْنَاكَهَا. There are several pronouns. We made you marry her, so we order you to marry her. Most of the marriages of the Prophet ﷺ was prearranged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a divine wisdom. So he married her. Did he want that on his own? He did not. But the Quran says زَوَّجْنَاكَهَا, we made you marry her. Why? لِكَيْ لَا يَكُونَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ حَرَجٌ فِي أَزْوَاجِ أَدْعِيَئِهِمْ. And this is where the question went wrong, when the brother or the questioner said that I should explain that it was a special case for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and it's not general. No! As a matter of fact, this special case was presented in this format through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in order to be generalized. In order to introduce the practical solution to the problem of adoption. And what does it mean? If you adopt a child from an orphanage, or his parents died and he does not have anyone to look after him, and now you raise them or you raise her, this person must keep the name of his family, of his father and grandfather. It is not permissible, it's a major sin to give him your own name or last name for legal reasons or under any circumstances. That also applies by analogy to the practice in the West where the woman, the wife, neglects her own family name and father's name and adopts her husband's name or last name when they get married. That too is illegal. So we concluded from the previous answer and the story that it is not permissible for anyone who's not the father of a child to give him his own last name, nor is it permissible for a husband to give his wife his own last name. Every person should keep their own name. أدعوهم لآبائهم وأقسط عند الله calling after you their own fathers. That is more just with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So no one should bear the name of any person other than his own father or family's name, and that is considered a major sin if they do so. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pre-planned this whole thing and arranged the marriage of Zaynab to Muhammad's adopted son before adoption was abrogated in that sense, then afterward adoption was abrogated, but it kept the concern of looking after orphans, sponsoring them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to marry Zaynab after Zayd had divorced her and after the Iddah, in order to tell everybody that your adopted sons are not your actual sons. So there is no mahramiyya relationship. And that will also benefit us in our today's world as follows. When I adopt a child, some couple who struggle to have children and they can't, then they end up adopting a child. If they adopt a boy or a girl, they keep them at home until the child reaches the age of puberty. Now there is a very important concern, which is, if it is a boy, then your wife, who is acting as his foster mother, now has to wear hijab before him. Why? Because he is not her son, unless if she had breastfed him 5 times, or at least her sister. If this is the case, we have to keep in mind that many cases where also we adopt a girl, and she grows up in our household, and now she's 18 or 20, and she's at marriageable age, and she's still sitting without hijab or wearing short clothes or short sleeves or before her foster father. Why? Because she calls him dad, and she gives him a hug and kisses and all of that. He's not dad. He's a righteous man who fostered you, who helped you, but this is the truth.